Highness, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the 59th International Astronomical Congress in Glasgow. My name is Piers Sellers. I'm an astronaut. There's a picture of me up there clinging onto the outside of the space station. But more importantly, I'm a graduate of Edinburgh University, which I think proves how robust and efficient the educational system is up here in Scotland in succeeding in graduating a wretch like me. The dancers were from the Esprit Academy of Gymnastics using music composed by Alex James for the European Rosetta Mission. The theme of this display was that set for Congress, from imagination to reality. Now, this is the fourth time that the Congress has been held in the United Kingdom, but the first time it's been held in Scotland. And I think Scotland is a great choice for this venue for many, many reasons, but I'll give you two good ones. First, Scots and astronauts both like to think of themselves as fearless, so we have that much in common. However, Scots have the edge. Astronauts are only very occasionally called on to prove how brave they are. Scots do it every day by eating haggis, that mysterious national dish. Now, the second reason is that the climate here is good for you. It's cool, it's refreshing, it's a little bit cloudy, which is good for your skin, and there are no hurricanes, which I personally like a lot. This is a picture of the island in the UK that I took 2 years ago from the Space Shuttle Discovery, and if you turn your head on your side, you can see that Glasgow on that day in July 2006 is sitting under its own little cloud. Actually, this picture of Glasgow could have been taken on pretty well any day. Now, the little white dots in Wales and Ireland are not clouds, they're dense clusters of sheep. To open the proceedings, I'd like to welcome to the podium the founder of Surrey Satellites and the chairman of the local organizing committee, Sir Martin Sweeting.
Thank you, Piers. Your Royal Highness, distinguished ministers and guests, colleagues, of which there are many, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the local organizing committee, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the opening ceremony of the 59th International Astronautical Congress, hosted by the United Kingdom here in the vibrant city of Glasgow, and we even have some sunshine this morning. More than 2,000 space professionals and students will be taking part in a week that is dedicated to exploring space, so that we may better understand our universe and promote applications of space technology for the benefit of mankind. Since the last Congress, 1 year ago in India, there have been many achievements in space that will be presented during the Congress. But we should also look forward and plan for a future in space, observing our planet to ensure that we are good custodians of its environment and people, whilst also travelling out into the solar system with robotic exploration and sustained human presence in Earth orbit. And then, of course, on further, back to the Moon, further on to Mars, and maybe beyond. Of course, I would like to thank His Royal Highness for gracing us with his presence today, our Space Minister, the UK Research Councils and the British National Space Centre for their support of this Congress. I welcome you all to Glasgow, to the Congress, its international exhibition, and I hope that you will have a stimulating and above all, an enjoyable week. And personally, I look forward to meeting many old friends and making new ones. Thank you.
Thanks, Martin. In September 1992, a young British singer called Tamsin Archer produced her first album entitled Great Expectations, and from it came a single about the Apollo program, which asked the question, did we fly to the moon too soon? and asking why the dream that she referred to as man's greatest adventure has seemed to have gone on hold very quickly. Her song went to the top of the UK hit parade and led to her band being awarded the following year a Brit Award for the best British breakthrough band, 4Bs. It has indeed been a long time since we've been to the moon, but finally, we're seeing not just plans, but actual hardware coming together for a return to the moon. So it seems appropriate to reprise that song at this gathering. So here, with her song, Sleeping Satellite, is Tasman Archer and her partner, John Hughes.
Fly.
Anytime. Beautiful. Now we have a short video welcoming delegates to the Congress from the British Prime Minister, Gordon Brown.
I'm sorry I can't be with you today, but I'm delighted to welcome you all to Britain, to the great Scottish city of Glasgow, and to this year's International Astronautical Congress. I'd like to thank the British Interplanetary Society. It's the world's oldest organisation dedicated to the exploration of space, for all of your hard work to make this year's event such a success. And also to congratulate you on your 75th birthday, which I know you'll be celebrating over the next few days. The theme of this year's conference is From Imagination to Reality. And today, far from being confined to the realms of far-flung galaxies or the pages of science fiction books, space is having a bigger impact than ever here on Earth. Our ability to monitor and forecast the impact of hurricanes, for example, has been greatly enhanced by the global network of weather satellite systems, including those developed here in Europe. And those same satellites mean we're able to monitor the change in polar ice caps and in ozone levels that result from climate change. Of all of mankind's activities, the exploration and exploitation of space is truly a global endeavor. It brings nations and peoples together in a common enterprise from which everyone on the planet stands to gain. And Britain recognizes the importance of space to our national development. So we'll continue to work with our friends in Europe and across the world to protect and manage the planet through global Earth studies, to support the technical and innovative industries, and to inspire more of our young people to take up science and follow in those early footsteps on the moon. In the words of the great British physicist Stephen Hawking, we will reach out to the stars to unlock discoveries that are of fundamental importance to mankind. So once again, I hope you'll have some productive and enlightening debates as you discuss these vital issues over the next few days. I wish you a very successful conference.
And now I want to introduce the Minister for Science and Industry, responsible for all space activities in the United Kingdom, the Right Honourable Mr. Ian Pearson.
Thank you, dears. Your Royal Highness, members of the IAF, respective heads of space agencies, Congress delegates and exhibitors. As the UK Minister for Space, I'd like to echo the Prime Minister and to extend to you a warm welcome from the UK government. This is the first time that the Congress has been held in the UK for more than 20 years. I'm delighted that it's being held here and in this fine city of Glasgow. The UK government recognises that space is highly innovative, one of the highest value-adding sectors, with the capability to be a key driver of the future knowledge economy. And this Congress provides us with an opportunity to raise awareness about the wider benefits of space to the public. I'm particularly pleased that Citizens Day on Friday will attract a large student audience. Now, I hope that they will be inspired to consider careers in science and in the space industry. Of course, many of the students that will be here on Friday have been involved in the competitions that we've been running throughout the year. And there will be an awards ceremony in the Exhibition Hall Lecture Theatre on Friday lunchtime that I highly recommend to you. One of the competitions for schools has been to design an instrument to fly on a small satellite. And the prize is to have the instrument actually built and flown on an SSTL satellite. So, thanks to Sir Martin Sweeting and SSTL, the winner will be the first school in space. I'd also like to commend to you the BNSC stand in the exhibition. And you might want to collect a copy of the summary report of the latest survey that we've done into the UK space industry. It's been released today and it shows that the UK space industry grew at 8% in 2006-07 with an overall value of approaching £6 billion, nearly double that of just a few years ago. And growth in jobs is equally impressive as well, with nearly 2,000 new high technology jobs to take the direct overall employment to 19,000. And I think space for each of our countries is becoming increasingly important as an industry. It's not just a noble endeavour, it's actually very good for our economies indeed. And as a government, we're justified to be proud of our world-leading capabilities in telecommunications and small satellites. Achievements this year include the completion of the Skynet 5 constellation built by Astrium, and the launch of the 5 Rapid Eye satellites based on the SSTL platform. And I'd also like to announce today the release of another important source of reference, the UK Space Directory. This new directory was produced in partnership between the Society of British Aerospace Companies, the Aerospace and Defence Knowledge Transfer Network, and BNSSE. And it's an excellent initiative that captures the key capabilities of the UK space community in a single resource, both online and in print. Of course, we've heard about the theme of this 59th Congress, from imagination to reality. And space offers us the opportunity to imagine, to increase our understanding of the universe. My Prime Minister referred to Stephen Hawking. I'd like to refer to another quote of his, when he was asked to choose between funding the International Space Station or the Large Hadron Collider that we've all heard so much recently about. He said that together they amounted for less than 1% of global GDP. And if we couldn't spend that on gaining new knowledge, then we didn't deserve to call ourselves human beings. I totally agree. The James Webb Space Telescope is due to be launched in 2013, and its 6-meter mirror will enable us to study the very distant universe, looking for the first stars and galaxies that ever emerged. This makes the telescope the ultimate time machine that will see the early universe in formation. And I'm delighted that the UK has a key role in this mission through the Astronomy and Technology Centre at Edinburgh and its European leadership of the telescope's MIRO instrument. And there's more information on this on the BNSC stand as well. I must say that I'm very much looking forward to looking around the exhibition myself, to meeting old and new friends as well. And I'd like to wish you all a very successful Congress and an enjoyable visit to the UK and to Scotland. Thank you very much indeed.
The view of Earth from space defies description. All the astronauts I've flown with, and other astronauts I haven't flown with, all wished that they could take everybody here on Earth with them to orbit so they could see for themselves the beauty and fragility of our home planet. Now, our next presentation is by award-winning creative director and music producer Kenji Williams, who developed a live audio-visual performance evoking our perspective of and connection to Earth. His work was inspired by talking with astronauts and the view from up there. Kenji combined NASA MODIS satellite imagery and his live trademark violin electronica music to make a beautiful fusion of art and science. His film, Bella Gaia, was shown at the NASA 50th anniversary celebrations in Washington recently, and today we are honored to have him perform for us live here today. Ladies and gentlemen, Bella Gaia by Kenji Williams. legacy. As I said at the beginning, today, for the first time, the International National Audiovisual Congress is in Scotland. Scotland has its own governing assembly, and here to welcome you on their behalf, that assembly, is that Scottish Minister for Education, Fiona Patrick.
Your Royal Highness, distinguished ministers, guests, ladies and gentlemen, in particular University of Edinburgh graduates, it is with great honour that I welcome you all to Scotland and to the city of Glasgow in particular. I'm delighted that Scotland has been chosen to host your annual conference. The Scottish Exhibition and Conference Centre is one of the best purpose-built venues in the UK. And the Clyde Auditorium, or Armadillo as it is called, is truly an iconic and inspiring building, an appropriate venue as we look to the stars and to the future. Space exploration is a truly inspirational science. It inspires us all with a vision of what man can achieve with science and technology that is literally out of this world. It inspires our public agencies and governments, and perhaps most importantly, it inspires our children. Across the world, there is a great need to attract young people into all science-based industries and to study science, technology, and engineering, and more generally, to help us meet the challenges that only science can solve for us. So what better topic is there than space science to help achieve this? Many of you here today are perhaps visiting Scotland for the first time. You may know Scotland as the home of many great inventions of the past, and more recently, where Dolly the Sheep was created. You may not immediately think of Scotland as a place strongly connected with space science. However, Scotland does, in fact, have a great interest in space technology, rooted in a very dynamic and high-quality science base. We also deliver state-of-the-art space technology through a number of our highly innovative companies. I'll give you just a few examples. The University of Strathclyde here in Glasgow has recently won €2 million of European Research Council funding for frontier research from visionary space systems based on their innovative solar sail technology research. The UK Astronomy Technology Centre at the Royal Observatory in Edinburgh is world renowned as a leading supplier for major astronomical observatories worldwide, such as the James Clerk Maxwell Telescope in Hawaii, James Clerk Maxwell, another great Scottish scientist, and the European Southern Observatory in Chile. He's also involved in the next generation of telescopes, the Extremely Large Telescope for Europe, a wonderfully titled invention. We have Star Dundee Limited, a spin-out company from the University of Dundee, which specialises in supporting users and developers of Spacewire. This is a communications technology being successfully used on many space missions by the European Space Agency, the Japanese Space Agency, and NASA. We have a spacecraft hardware company, Clyde Space Limited, founded here in Glasgow, which designs power supplies, batteries, and solar panels for small satellites all over the world. We have recently been awarded an Innovation Triangle Initiative contract from the European Space Agency. And the Scottish Universities Physics Alliance, who are achieving excellence in astrophysics and space research. So there is no doubt scientists here in Scotland have a key role to play in the global space effort. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our hosts for this event, the British Interplanetary Society, for bringing this Congress to Scotland for the first time, and to congratulate them on their 75th anniversary. I wish you all a very successful Congress and hope you enjoy your stay here in the city of Glasgow as we all make a reality of our imagination. Thank you very much.
Scottish film music is popular throughout the world. Since graduating from the Royal Scottish Academy of Music, Simone Welsh has become a leading performer of traditional Scots fiddle and is much in demand for events and festivals in Scotland and overseas. Here, accompanied by Ian Muir, is Simone Welsh.
Excellent. I'm very happy now to introduce the President of the British Interplanetary Society, Mr. John Harlow, who will in turn introduce Mr. Jim Simmerman, the President of the International Astronautical Federation, a lot of acronyms, who will formally open this Congress. John?
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends. At long last, I can welcome you to this fabulous city of Glasgow. First, I'd like to make one or two acknowledgements following on from Sir Martin's acknowledgement of the support we've received from Her Majesty's Government through BNSC. That was in London. I would like to thank the people of Scotland and particularly the people we worked with here in Glasgow. And there are two teams up here that supported us really very professionally, and it was a real pleasure to work with. Those two teams are here in SCCC under John Sharkey, and the other team was Scott Taylor's team for the Glasgow City Marketing Board. It was a real pleasure to work with you, and they did very well. Thank you very much, you guys.
Okay, just one more acknowledgement. I don't know how to say this about this lady. She's still working hard behind the scenes now, just with me. She was taken on by our society to help out at the last International Astronautical Congress that was held here in the UK in 1987 in Brighton. And she should have known better. What we tried to do with our local organising committee was to have a small team that could be very reactive, and they were supported by other small teams that were tasked, and they would report back to us. But slowly as we grew more and more busy, and nearer this time, the workload increased. And so this lady took on more and more, clearly more team was required. She took on another series of people. And in fact, as she got busier, the knock-on really is into your family life as well. And I would like to thank very much Suzanne Parry for all the good work she's put in. This Congress would not have been here without her work. Thank you very much, Suzanne.
And one of the first duties of a local organising committee is to determine what theme should be for the Congress. And as we've heard, this year, October in fact, happens to be the 75th anniversary of our society. So what better theme to take than our society motto, from imagination to reality. Now, okay, we could try and imagine the realities of 1933, we could read books, we could watch History Channel, but I would suggest that it's quite difficult for most of us to imagine the realities of 1933. As an aside, I could say here, I'm very pleased and very happy to welcome some of our learned colleagues and friends who have actually witnessed 1933, so they will know some of the realities of that time. And it's good to see them here. They've made it. Well done. Now, you can imagine a small team, dedicated team, enthusiasts in 1933, trying to imagine ways of going around, and escape from the planet Earth. They must have been imagining velocities of thousands or tens of thousands of feet per second. They knew their physics. Not the least thing, they had to control these velocities. But generally, I would say to you that it was a difficult thing for the population to imagine what the realities of 2008 might be 75 years from that date. We could say today, if we did the same thing and asked the general population what their imagination of the realities of 2083 might be, it would also be difficult. They could perhaps extrapolate some of their universe into the future, but it would be fairly difficult. I'm sure life in 2083 will have its ups and downs, but another thing I'm sure is that it will be a very exciting time.
So I would like to take this opportunity to invite all of you to join us in celebrating our 75th anniversary during this week. That opportunity will start sooner than you think. Now, after all the hard work, we are ready. I'm sure you are ready. But there's one more thing I would ask of you. Whenever you get a time to have a break, have fun and enjoy yourselves. Thank you very much. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce someone who's steadfastly helped the IAF over the led the IAF over the last few years. Interesting and sometimes difficult task, but he's done very well, in my opinion, exceptionally well. So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you the President, Dr. Jim Zimmern.
As we open the 59th IAC, I want to express appreciation to the British Interplanetary Society that organized this very impressive event. This is the fourth time an International Astronautical Congress has been held in the United Kingdom. On the first occasion, also organized by the BIS in London in 1951, several visionary space societies met to establish an International Astronautical Federation. In 1959, the Congress returned to London, and on that occasion, the IAF members created two additional groups, an honorary society called the International Academy of Astronautics, and a legal society called the International Institute of Space Law. Today, these two organizations operate independently, but continue to work very closely with our federation. I want to thank the volunteers of the Academy, of the Institute, and of the Federation who work and have worked together tirelessly to organize this Congress. The third Congress in the UK was held in Brighton in 1987. Those of us who attended will, I'm sure, recall that an unforecast hurricane struck Southeast England right in the midst of the Congress. Let's hope that this year's IAC is not quite that eventful. A great deal has happened since the IAC was first held in London 57 years ago. 16 technical papers were presented during the 1951 Congress. More than 1,400 will be presented this year. 14 space societies from Europe and the Americas met in 1951 to establish the IAF. Today, the Federation comprises 200 space agencies, companies, nonprofit organizations, research institutes, and societies from all over the world. Participants in the 1951 IAC wrote about artificial satellites and interplanetary spaceflight. Since then, the space age began with the launch of Sputnik, and we have witnessed the success of a multitude of programs and missions, including Apollo, Tyros, Helios, Mir, Voyager, ISS, Huygens, Hayabusa, Hubble, Giotto, Pathfinder, Cartosat, Chandra, Seabirds, San Marco, COMSAT, and Shenzhou, which just yesterday marked the successful launching and landing yesterday of the Shenzhou 7 spacewalk mission. But while the world has changed dramatically during the past half century, some things remain the same. Space is exciting. The early participants were dreamers. Today we continue to dream of
projects that expand the frontiers of human knowledge, create new markets, and improve the quality of life here on Earth. Space is challenging. Launching satellites and humans into space entails risk and occasionally results in failure. These failures remind us of the uncertainties we constantly face. And space is international. Arthur C. Clarke, Leslie Shepard, who is here with us today, and Eugen Sanger, and the many others who founded the IAF, believed in international cooperation. Today, as we launch missions to explore the solar system and use satellites to monitor the health of our planet, working together is more than an attractive option. It's often a necessity. During the Congress this week, we will be reminded of these themes as we discuss our accomplishments and explore new initiatives for the next 50 years. I hope your stay in Glasgow is both productive and memorable. And now I declare the 59th International Astronautical Congress open.